Welcome back. In the last lecture, we sketched the structure of American surveillance law. Now we're going to walk through a few components of legal proceedings that figure prominently in surveillance practice. Let me apologize in advance. This material is a little dry and a little eclectic, but it's essential to understanding the more exciting stuff. There are five topics on deck for this lecture. First, grand juries. These bodies are an unusual feature of the American legal system and possess important investigative powers. Second, ex parte hearings. In these special proceedings, government agents can get judicial permission for surveillance. Third, quash and suppression motions. These are important legal vehicles for challenging a particular instance of surveillance. Fourth, judicial contempt. This topic deals with how courts enforce their orders. Last, appeals. We'll work through what can be appealed, the timing of appeals, and the hierarchy of American courts. So, let's start with grand juries. You're likely familiar with trial juries, or in the mangled legalese, petit juries. Those consist of roughly a dozen jurors, sit all day for usually a few days to a few weeks, hear just one case, and ultimately decide the facts in that case. Jury trials are open to the public, and they're supervised by a presiding judge. A trial jury is not the same as a grand jury. They are very different in their composition, their procedure, and the role they play in the American legal system. The grand jury is a holdover institution from early American law. Under the Fifth Amendment, it is required in serious federal criminal cases. Many of the eastern states have also retained the grand jury. As the name implies, a grand jury is larger than a trial jury, usually including about 20 jurors. A grand jury is impaneled for months, and sometimes for over a year. Service is not ordinarily a full-time commitment, though. Grand juries are often involved in many cases, from dozens to even hundreds. The grand jury is tasked with investigating crimes, and it has powerful tools for doing that. Specifically, it can compel individuals to both appear as witnesses and bring evidence. That includes electronic evidence. Ultimately, the grand jury evaluates the probability that specific crimes have been committed. If it concludes by a vote that there is probable cause, then it returns a so-called true bill indictment. That document allows prosecutors to move forward with their case. Grand jury proceedings are secret. Jurors are forbidden from discussing them, as are prosecutors. Only the witnesses can choose to describe their experiences before the grand jury. As you've likely surmised by now, grand juries closely collaborate with prosecutors. They're formally independent of prosecutors, and in fact, they originally acted as a populist check on prosecutorial power. In practice, though, prosecutors run the show. They put on the evidence, and they draft the indictments. There is no judge present, and a witness cannot even bring his or her attorney. Perhaps the most famous observation on grand juries is from a former chief judge of New York's highest court. He quipped to a reporter that prosecutors exercise so much control over grand juries that they could get them to, quote, indict a ham sandwich, unquote. With apologies to the vegetarians in the audience. All right, that's enough about grand juries. Let's turn to the next subject, ex parte proceedings. Ex parte is a bit of legal Latin with a simple meaning. In most legal proceedings, including civil cases and criminal prosecutions, there are two adversarial sides. In an ex parte proceeding, there is just one side. Many surveillance procedures involve an ex parte proceeding. Law enforcement officers will provide some information, and a judge can then issue an order allowing for surveillance. Perhaps the best known form of surveillance order is a search warrant, which we'll discuss soon. That's it for ex parte proceedings. Now on to quash and suppression motions. At some point, you might hear a motion to quash called, funnily enough, a motion to squash. No, this has nothing to do with autumn vegetables, or squishing. It's a motion to quash, and it has a simple role. When a party seeks to quash something, called quashal, all it's asking for is an invalidation. A motion to quash a surveillance order, which we'll encounter soon, is simply a challenge to that order's validity. Note that a motion to quash is a procedural vehicle. It has to cite specific grounds for quashal. So, for example, the target of a surveillance order might argue that it wasn't sufficiently precise. A motion to suppress is also straightforward. It means, simply, that evidence should not be admissible at trial. Once again, this is a procedural vehicle. There have to be specific grounds for suppression. We'll see how a criminal defendant, for example, might be able to suppress evidence when police conduct a search without a warrant. It's important to note that suppression is solely about using evidence in a case. The evidence can be used in other contexts, including public relations and policymaking. The final point I would like to make about these motions is that they are often paired together. When contesting surveillance in a criminal case, a defendant will try to invalidate the surveillance order. He will also try to have the surveillance evidence ruled inadmissible because it was collected under an invalid order. Those two challenges are, as we just saw, quashal and suppression. Alright, we've finished with the quirky criminal procedure. Now let's briefly discuss contempt of court. When a court issues an order, it needs some way of enforcing that order. For our purposes, contempt is simply a court's set of tools for enforcing its orders. There are two types of contempt that you should be aware of. First, civil contempt. This is the far more common form. If someone mentions contempt of court, you should generally assume they're discussing civil contempt. The purpose of civil contempt is to coerce compliance. While a court can order whopping fines, and even incarceration, the point is to secure specific conduct. As soon as a party complies, the contempt comes to an end. That's why, when explaining civil contempt, many attorneys note that a person holds the keys to their own jail cell. The second form of contempt is criminal, and it has a different purpose. Criminal contempt is intended to punish a party for not complying with a court order. In effect, criminal contempt spins off a whole new criminal prosecution from an existing case. It's quite rare in practice. And so again, when you hear contempt, you should generally think civil contempt. Alright, that's it for contempt of court. The last subject for this lecture is a feature of the American legal system that is critically important and often misunderstood, the appeal. An appeal is, simply, a claim that a court was wrong. A party goes to a higher, reviewing court and asks for a different result. Much like the motions we just talked about, an appeal is a procedural vehicle. An appealing party, called an appellant, has to give specific grounds for the appeal. Those grounds might be that the lower court got the law wrong. A party might claim that the court misinterpreted a statute, for instance. Alternatively, the grounds for appeal might be that the lower court got specific facts wrong. A party could argue, for example, that there was insufficient evidence of a crime. The distinction between legal grounds for appeal and factual grounds for appeal is critical. You see, when a higher court reviews a lower court, it begins its analysis of the merits by noting a standard of review. The basic idea is that lower courts sometimes deserve deference. Trial courts, for instance, are usually much more familiar with the facts of a case. So, an appellate court does not always simply ask whether the lower court was wrong. Often it applies a higher standard of review, asking whether the lower court was really wrong. Let's return to appeals based on law and based on fact. When appealing a legal issue, usually the higher court provides no formal deference to the lower court's ruling. It simply substitutes its own judgment. In the legalese, that's called de novo review. When appealing a factual issue, by contrast, usually the higher court does defer to the lower court's findings. By default, when an appellate court reviews facts, it asks whether the lower court made a clear error. These standards of review are, again, the defaults. They can change, and in particular, they are ratcheted far upwards if a party fails to raise an issue in the trial court. Let me briefly touch on the timing of appeals. Ordinarily, an appeal occurs only after proceedings have entirely finished in the trial court. There are a number of exceptions, though, so don't be too surprised if you see an appeal while a case is still moving forward. Those are called interlocutory appeals. The last subject I'll cover on appeals is the hierarchical structure of the American court system. Here at Stanford, the federal trial court is the United States District Court for the Northern District of California. That's where federal cases begin. Appeals from that court go to the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, where they are heard by a three-judge panel. Trial courts, by contrast, usually only have one judge. If you don't like the result from the three-judge panel, you can seek a new opinion from a larger panel of judges. That's called en banc review. The last stop in the federal appellate hierarchy is the Supreme Court of the United States. The Supreme Court, often simply called the court for convenience, has the final judicial say on federal law. The court takes relatively few cases, so you should generally not expect an appeal to land there. That completes our picture of the federal hierarchy. At the lowest level is a district court. Next up is a court of appeals. And finally, the Supreme Court is at the top. At present, the United States is divided into 94 federal judicial districts, each of which has its own district court. Each of those districts, in turn, falls into one of 12 geographic appellate circuits. This map reflects the boundaries of the district and circuit courts. All of the appellate discussion has, thus far, focused on the federal judiciary. Let me briefly address state courts. Each state has its own judicial system, and they are largely parallel to the federal system. Here at Stanford, the state trial court is the superior court for Santa Clara County. Next up is a state intermediate appellate court. Here, the first appellate district of the California Court of Appeal. Finally, each state has at least one highest court. Here, the Supreme Court of California. On issues of state law, the state's highest court has the final judicial say. On issues of federal law, though, one last appeal is possible. You can seek review from the Supreme Court of the United States. All right. We've covered a ton of ground in this lecture, and I promise we're now on the very last topic related to appeals, the role of precedent. Each court is required to follow decisions by its higher courts. In legalese, these appellate rulings have binding authority. So, once a higher court rules on an issue of law, that view of the law applies to all the courts below it. When a judicial opinion is not by a higher court, it is not formally binding. It can, of course, still influence judicial thinking. These rulings are called persuasive authority. Whenever you read a judicial opinion, keep in mind where the court falls in the hierarchy of American law, and where exactly that opinion will be binding. In some areas of law, we'll see appellate courts in total disagreement. That means the legality of a surveillance practice sometimes depends on where the surveillance occurs and which government agency conducts that surveillance. Phew, so that's it for appeals, and that wraps up the material for this lecture. Thanks for sticking through the dry stuff. I promise it'll be worth it. In the next lecture, we're going to cover the basics of reading legal materials. Most of the texts for the course are government documents produced by lawyers, and they can be a little tricky to approach.